This program is recorded and presented by Chippewa Valley Community Television. This is a rebroadcast of the Eau Claire City Council work session meeting. The audio for this program can be heard on WRFP LP 101.9 FM.
So welcome to work session number 3 regarding the 2017 operating budget for the City of Eau Claire. As is our custom, the work sessions will be run by Dale, our City Manager, Mr. Jay, our Chief Financial Officer. John.
Yeah, I don't have any follow-up from the last meeting. Have not received any questions in the meantime, so why don't we just go ahead and get started. It looks like it's, for the most part, the Phil show here this afternoon and into the evening, so take her away, Phil.
One last time. Thanks, Jay and Dale. Of course, we would start out right away with some changes, so we're on page C27. So, to answer the question about whether or not Jay is going to change the operating budget to reflect department changes, so what I'm referring to is going away from Public Works and Parks, Recreation, and Forestry and going to Community Service. I'm assuming for 2017 we'll move forward with this budget in these headings and then make changes.
Yeah, what I was thinking was that we won't make the changes before the council adopts the budget, because really none of the numbers change. It's more organizational, but that before we publish the adopted budget, we'll go ahead and make those organizational changes within the budget document itself. So I wasn't planning to turn it around in the next couple of weeks. Have those changes made, but we'll get that done after the council adopts the budget and before we get it posted on the website.
Could I ask one more question about that then? So does the budget for engineering lift exactly out of here and over?
Yes.
To
yeah.
Yep. And these little graphics will be changed?
Yes.
Yeah, we'll get all the organizational pieces changed.
So to clarify, it was a charter ordinance that doesn't go into effect for 60 days, and it's the 2017 budget. So what we'll be doing is queuing all this up so that when we put things out on the website, when we have the final budget, all of that, it'll be aligned to reflect that change at that point. As Jay pointed out, the numbers stay the same. The current engineering budget just gets lifted out of what's Public Works now, moved over, becomes its own department, and then there'll be the title changes of Community Service.
I was really interested in that budget piece.
So if you have questions about engineering, this would be the appropriate time. Or in this presentation. So as we in public service know, when the economy is down, it's a great time to invest in technology, to invest in training staff, and to plan for the future. And our department and our city, I think, has done a really good job of that. We have transfer center plans. We have a master plan for transportation development. Wastewater collection master plan is being worked on right now. Water distribution modeling program plan was done in the past year. Stormwater plan is being done right now. The waterways plan was updated in 2012. We finally completed a buildings inventory as part of the City Council strategic plan. We did that and been working on that last year. We've made significant fleet improvements. We've made some significant changes in the philosophy of how we maintain things. And of course, our department is very ingrained in maintenance, and we've changed from changed to a philosophy of preventive maintenance and away from a philosophy of reactive maintenance, waiting for things to break and then fix them, finding out how to fix them. So we're shifting to a preventive maintenance philosophy. We've also implemented a number of efficiencies in things such as mowing, building maintenance, garbage pickup, technology, street and alley improvements. So we've continued to do those things here when we didn't necessarily have the budgets in place to make significant improvements. We did make the plans for it, and we've invested in planning for when things would turn around. I feel like we finally reached that starting point. As we mentioned, Community Service becomes the new Parks, Recreation, and Forestry and Public Works Department. as Jay mentioned, will shift, should be a gradual change to shift into that. Even as we implement changes with things such as adding the business manager, the community services, that'll happen halfway through the year. And then we'll talk about some of the other changes that will take place. Both departments, even though we're going to have an engineering department and a community services department, we're both committed to working well together. I think that over the last few years, we've done a really good job of making sure that each of us knows what each other's five-year plan is. So that we know we're replacing utilities in the street, and we're not chip sealing a street the year before. We want everybody to be on the same page in terms of replacing utilities, replacing streets, curb and gutter, right down to our trees, to our urban forest, which is planted on those trees. We've also most recently created a second electrician position within the city and named a parking administrator. We're very happy to be moving forward in both of those directions. That would be a big help for everyone throughout the city, regardless of what department we're for. So we're on page C27 to start out with. And I think it's probably best if anyone has any questions, you just jump in right away as long as we're there. What we're talking about today, what I'm trying to highlight are some primary opportunities and some issues that face our departments, our divisions. So what we have within engineering and GIS, we have increased demands for engineering services to address an increasingly aging and deteriorating infrastructure, along with new infrastructure to support a growing city and with current staffing levels. So we're not talking about adding any people within the engineering department. We've created a parking administrator position with some creative funding with actually a vacancy within the streets department, street maintenance department. Another issue that Dave in engineering is going to be dealing with is a complex parking system that needs to be updated to meet rapidly changing conditions in our rapidly redeveloping downtown. And parking will always be an issue, but we feel good that to have a parking administrator name and have someone have a handle on that. We also think there will be increasing demands to support private development and the Community Development Services Department with their efforts to help develop private development. So engineering is taking on an increasingly broad role with not just doing engineering items. And I think if you ask Dave how much actual engineering he does as compared to community development, it's probably higher on the community development side. And that's a good thing. That's a good position for Clark to be in. Are there any questions about the engineering or the GIS? GIS continues to be a very growing program. GIS used to be an engineering only type function. And now we find that every department, every division, from forestry to the health department, everyone needs GIS services. And we're going to see almost an insatiable demand for more GIS services to help people, to help us provide our services, to have that GIS information.
Hey, Phil, if I could, a little bit on the GIS. We are working with the county to create a county-wide seamless map. That's currently not the situation. There's some things that have to happen with new technology called parcel fabric mapping, and there's some conversion things that have to happen with that. But we are working to be at a point. Hopefully, it might be a year, 18 months before it's actually going to be there. But that we'd be offering countywide one seamless map that works for basically the platform for all these other applications to attach to. So just, I don't know, Dave, do you have anything you want to add to that? But it's a big project that we're working on.
After we'll start January 1st, we have some assistance lining up to help us with that. We have Shane Harmson, our GIS administrator, that's going to spearhead it. But it'll be something that'll be wonderful for the citizens to have done, whether you're in the city or outside of the city, to go to one source and have one map. Plus, it's a requirement from state law.
Eventually it would be a requirement. And also building on that, just that we would be looking at probably moving some of the maintenance, not entering the data in it, but in terms of the technology and running the technology, some of that would be shifting over to our IS department, because it is, you know, basically it's an IS application that has been housed primarily within engineering, and we're going to have a little more of a split between what IS does and what engineering is providing for that base map for all of the rest of the services.
What are we doing to make it easier for developers and other people to file and get permits, you know, meet all the requirements of our various ordinances? So, you know, because every now and then we hear the comment that it's a very onerous process.
So a couple of, I don't see Daryl here.
That's Daryl's problem.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, Daryl's not, but to that, actually, several years ago, actually, we did a, it was called, his nickname was DAPIT, but it was a process review of our permitting process, where we went through all of our the steps that a developer works through. We involved the development community. We made several improvements to that in terms of some online submittals, and certainly some of the things that they can get online. It was interesting. The feedback that we received was actually interesting. When we had outside developers that typically work outside of our community or work a lot in other communities as well as ours, we received very positive feedback about how efficiently and quickly you can work through the city of Eau Claire in development. When we talked to developers that work pretty much only in the city of Eau Claire, they felt that we could do a better job at being more efficient and effective in helping them with that process. So. So it was an interesting set of feedback, kind of depending on where, you know, where you, other places that you can compare to. But it is something that we continually look at, and I know that there are a couple more steps that they wanted to take in terms of making those improvements. But and frankly, I can't remember exactly what they are.
I can tell you one thing we just did recently is to allow minor site plans to be administratively reviewed, so they no longer have to come to the plan commission. So that would be all duplexes, for example. So that's taken some of the time and burden off of that development.
Okay. How do we coordinate with Eau Claire County? I realize we don't get involved in the approval in the county, but is there any, because the comment that was made to me the other day is that Eau Claire County is very tough to work with. And does that relate, I mean, that doesn't really impact us.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if your development's in the city, you're dealing with us. If it's in the county, it's in the county. So I don't know.
You sure do a fine job.
Yes. So I know that they work at their processes and are, you know, reviewing them as well. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
I don't know if this is the right place to ask, but we have a drone policy, right?
We do. We have an ordinance prohibiting drones. We do allow them in the parks if you get permission from Park and Rec Director. WIA has a very stringent number of restrictions on flying drones over their sanctioned events. Wisconsin.
Yeah.
So one of the most common first uses of drones was by sports teams. as you can imagine, trying to gain an advantage in their competition, so the WIA was very come out with a policy that prohibited that. We do allow them in our parks as long as they're not flying over a crowd, they're not flying over a WIA sanctioned event, and permission of the event users. But the city does have a policy that prohibits. So every once in a while we see a drone view of the river or whatever, and not sure always where they come from, but we try to remind people when they are supposed to get permission.
Or certain DOT bridge project.
Yeah,
you happen to have a lot of aerial photos that were taken by a drone.
My understanding
that
it was actually a camera attached to a pigeon.
Well,
trained by the
DOT. Or a goose. Or a goose.
Escape
the DNR issue.
This is the direction we're going on.
This is perfect.
Okay, I have a serious question. I meant that was serious.
All right.
Beyond
serious.
The pigeon.
The pigeon.
All right.
The pigeon wasn't serious.
might have been. I apologize if I'm making a wrong assumption. I do digress. A parking administrator. We had received some feedback about just the high amount of congestion in the older ramp here. And on issues such as that, do we anticipate that the new parking administrator will be able to be proactive and working on kind of ironing out the glitches that we can't control where this ramp is and the age of it and all that kind of stuff, but just kind of increasing and improving the flow?
That's what we'd like to do. We want to finally have a person, a point person for parking, and that is Todd Bohr. That's who we'd like people to go to. Now, the parking ramp across the street has a number of issues that cross many division lines, as I'll talk about a little while later. It's a 44-year-old parking ramp. We're life expectancy of 50 years. It's time is coming. So that is something that's going to need to be dealt with. But I think sharing those concerns with the parking administrator is the best way to go, because Todd will have solutions. He has knowledge of the other two parking ramps and other surface lots that can be used to help alleviate issues. Mm-hmm.
Could you point to that position in the budget? Where is that located?
So,
what's it called?
On page C30.
Actually, I think it's on page F7, Phil.
You shifted it from...
Yeah, it's in the parking utility.
From C30
page
to
F7,
the
parking administrator.
Thank you. That's all. Thank you for binding the booklets this year. Actually.
You're most welcome.
Thank you.
So that will start January
1? No, he's
doing it now. We put that in effect probably about August or so.
So with the new change, Todd actually reports to today like he does now. So the parking administration would be under the engineering department, as well as Leah. Leah, the transportation engineer, is also in there. Leah works very closely with Todd also.
I have two questions.
Mm-hmm.
Regarding the mapping, mm-hmm. I was at a meeting last week up in Ashland to do with flooding, and I heard that they were developing, the Regional Plan Commission was developing flooding maps that essentially showed every property in the county that could allow them to model exactly what sort of damage might be done through, you know, if a flood event happens. I was wondering, is that sort of tied into what's being developed through the county? Is it to do with emergency management as well?
So that would be a subset of the maps that, so you have the base maps, and we have developed, I guess they'd be called flood prediction maps. Mm-hmm. So that when we have a predicted, a level of say 773 or 775, at the Grand Avenue Bridge, if that's the predicted level, we can pull up those maps and they will tell us the areas that should likely be impacted by that level, and then take the appropriate action to either protect the property or notify the property owners and that sort of thing.
So that already exists.
Those maps do already exist. Mm-hmm. We built those models probably about 3 years ago. Mm-hmm.
That's an excellent example of how GIS can help communities plan for flooding. And of course, Eau Claire did a lot of flood remediation, Taft, and a lot of these defense ponds were purchased, and we now have, we're out of the news. When we have large rains like we've had this past year, we're just not a community that's affected. Our stormwater system is doing a good job of keeping up with it.
Yeah.
For the most part, I mean, not everyone is out of the woods, but for the most part, we do a very good job of handling stormwater.
So that's an important distinction. Those maps that I just spoke of are based upon the river flooding, not surface water flooding.
Not
a big rain event. So we do not have predicting flood maps for rain events, mm-hmm. but we do for river flooding mm-hmm. events.
Okay, so the next item in here is,
Yep, we're good.
Okay. Buildings and grounds. So what's happened with the reorganization is buildings and grounds is now split between community services and engineering. So what we've done is taken Rod Bonesteel, who was in charge of buildings and grounds, and asked Rod to be in charge of long-term infrastructure improvement of buildings. And then we've asked the Parks Division to be in charge of custodial, day-to-day custodial functions of our buildings. So we think that that division of duties will allow a greater concentration by Rodney to chart out a plan for improving and maintaining our physical facilities so that we know exactly which buildings need roofs, need windows, need boiler replacement, need heat pump replacement, need those things, and what year they need them. And then he's going to have a very big job in trying to identify by year which of those buildings need to be replaced. And that's something that we've not really done. Again, as I mentioned earlier, we've been reactive. We kind of waited till roofs failed. We waited till boilers and heat pumps failed. And we're now changing that philosophy and trying to get ahead of that.
You're splitting this between community services and engineering?
No, he's going to be moved to engineering. And his only job will be to previously having two functions, the long-term maintenance and the day-to-day custodial maintenance. We're taking the custodial maintenance away from him and just giving him the infrastructure, those projects. So he'll be managing projects that involve improvements within buildings. So writing specs for new roofs, determining which facility, whether it's a fire station or a reservoir needs painting, or he's going to be the one that's going to have to decide which takes a higher priority. And then the day-to-day custodial will be shifted to the Parks Department. And then Parks Department will be able to help the custodial staff that currently works with all of our buildings, whether it's City Hall, the fire station, or not the fire station, the library, and the central maintenance, and then all the smaller buildings.
Because before you had the custodial function split, you had the bigger buildings under Rod, and all of the smaller buildings and Parks buildings were being handled by Todd and Parks, and so we'll have all the custodial now, you know, reporting to Todd.
So the engineering budget is changing. It's not moving exactly.
Well, but it was all under Public Works Administration.
Yeah, but to your point, you're right. So to the extent that the salary and benefits for Rod were under this building and grounds, that will go over and become part of engineering.
And, did you say that custodial is going to be moved under Todd now?
Yes.
Day-to-day.
Just the day-to-day, right.
So the thought process there is park buildings. We clean restrooms every day within parks.
We clean hobs, we clean the pool.
Correct. Mm-hmm. So we'll be able to share. There'll still be a team cleaning approach for things like floor waxing and carpet cleaning. We'll be able to assemble a team of workers to go in and attack these things at night, get them done, get out of there. Mm-hmm. We think we can improve the quality at some of the facilities. When someone is sick, then we have a resource. The previous custodial pool was only 7 workers, so when somebody's on vacation or sick, not necessarily have a great resource bank back there to draw on, but now we'll incorporate the park people to help with those services. So one of the things that we found in our recent inventory is we have 177 buildings and we manage 450,000 square feet. So one of the things that we should be thinking about down the road here is should we think about reducing the number of structures and facilities we have and instead have larger facilities which are easier to maintain. So those are things that down the road that the city and the city council should be thinking about. And I already mentioned that the grounds duties, mowing the lawns in front of the library, city hall, all these facilities should be done essentially. And then again, this process will happen over time. Any questions on buildings and grounds and changes there? Okay, so moving on to community service streets. One of the issues that Steve and his crew feel is that maintaining a growing infrastructure with same size staff and equipment becomes an issue. the city continues to grow, and obviously we hope always will. But there have not been significant increases in staff or equipment for streets. At some point in time, we'll need to think about adding additional staff to maintain the added infrastructure, including when we start talking about doing more alley maintenance. That adds to our workload. So one of the things that Streets is trying to do is educate staff to keep up with changes in technology. Every year, the equipment that we use gets more technologically advanced, and training will need to be properly maintained and operate efficiency. The old days of driving a snowplow and hitting a handle every once in a while to disperse salt is kind of a done deal. All of that is operated by a computer. It needs to be calibrated by the driver and regulated by the driver. But you need to be able to drive, operate a wing plow, front plow, and handle dispersing salt. And if you see, we have a media day coming up next Thursday, and you'll get a chance to see one of these. It's almost closer to a Cessna dashboard airplane than a snowplow. It's pretty impressive. So our staff needs to continue to keep up with that technology as we take advantage of that technology, because it saves us money. We can be more effective in the salt that we put down. We also need to start planning for changes in the central maintenance facility. The shops need to be expanded, and space probably needs to be added for storage of equipment and materials. I know we have a lot of buildings, but they're kind of spread out and maybe not as accessible as would be ideal. One of the things that Streets would like the council and management team to consider is having remote storage areas on the west, north, and south sides of town. So that might involve storing an end loader and a salt storage area in those parts of town, so that as a truck came empty, they didn't have to drive all the way back down to central maintenance facility or remote, that they could do a better job if they had some remote locations.
And to that end, I'm having some discussions with the county because they have also some similar needs about possibly co-locating a facility that might, be more on the edge of our, edge of town for us, but, helps the county out, and it could be a shared facility between the city and the county. So we're exploring a couple of possibilities.
Isn't that a contradiction between what you just said about wanting to have maybe larger, easier to maintain single facilities, and then now you're talking about spreading out different facilities?
Well, I don't think it's a contradiction. I think it's one of the same. Those facilities need to be bigger to handle the increased storage. It would be better to have a central facility than many small facilities.
You're suggesting we should have smaller facilities in different parts
those facilities in a smaller part of town could be bigger, and then we could perhaps eliminate three or four smaller areas, but it would be relocated in a more geographically beneficial part of town.
So you're saying we have other small ones now located throughout the city, and we consolidate those in more strategic locations?
That's part of it. That's we have storage materials
tucked away in a lot of places.
So the idea would be to have bigger ones strategically placed and consolidate some of the smaller ones.
Are we talking about land acquisitions to make this a reality?
I don't know if it'll go that far, but in these discussions with the county and actually even the school district a little bit, there might need to be some land acquisition. I don't know that we would be the lead on it. It might be one of those organizations being the lead, and then we would be a partner in it with them. So it's still early in the discussion process. But.
The most critical item for the Streets Division here is snow storage. So as you may or may not know, our primary storage area is where the cannery will be going. So as we lose the cannery district for snow storage, we also store snow at Sky Park and then also at Galloway Street. Now, the last couple of years, snow storage has not really been an issue. But if we lose the cannery to development, which is a good thing, we just also need to remember that we have to have a place for snow storage. So we need to look at areas, and having a site close to downtown really helps. it's most important, we feel, to have an area close by so that we can haul snow from the business districts. Because that's the area of town where you really can't get in till 2 o'clock. And there's no parking and you really need to be cleaned up and out of there by sunup. But
that's where most of the hauling takes place.
So, and that's where most of the hauling takes place. So the idea is to have a place close by downtown. We've been working with, we've been trying to work with the railroad to actually access a site that we own, and that would be underneath the Claremont Bridge behind the tennis center. But in order to access that site, we have to get permission and we have to have a river crossing that has to be built or at least authorized by the railroad. And we're having great difficulty accessing that. The attorney's office is working on that and has even reached a stumbling block at the railroad commissioner's office in Madison. So part of what we need to do is prove that there was a railroad crossing there at one time, which many people remember, but we need to have.
We need pictures.
We need pictures. We need
so if anyone has pictures.
Yeah. So,
I bet she does.
Yeah. Okay.
Does snow storage have to be on the river? Is there no other place anywhere near downtown?
No, but the layout of our community is that's the most advantageous place.
How many acres do we need, Bill, for snow storage?
What'd you figure, Steve? 3 to 4 acres?
3 to 4 acres.
Wow. So 3 to 4 acres is about the size of a softball field or two?
To your perspective. Concern, though, the site that we're looking at off of Galloway would be designed differently than what we have off of 3rd in the Canary District at the 1st, I guess, in that we would be putting different control mechanisms in place to trap the water, so I mean, the water wouldn't run right into the river. And you know, there'd be some best practices that we'd be putting in place that practically aren't fully in place at the current facility. So wherever we move this to, we will be upgrading the way we handle that runoff water.
And under the Claremont Bridge would be an ideal spot.
Because 53 High Bridge.
Under the High Bridge?
Not where you're talking
about? No. Claremont Bridge.
If you're taking take Galloway as you're headed up to River Prairie, and you can cut down back and go behind the tennis center.
Where the skate park used to be?
That's not Hastings Way.
That's what I was going to say.
It's behind the tennis center, the YMCA tennis center.
I know where you're talking about. It's just not Claremont.
So we would be able to install stormwater management areas there. It's an area that more than likely is never going to be developed. So that, to us, would be a great site to invest some time and energy, because it's close to downtown. But no, it doesn't have to be on the river. It's just, that's just a site that just happens to be there. Okay, anything else on Public Works? Otherwise, we move to.
Thank you for commenting on those large future needs. It's really helpful.
Okay, the next area would be community service of Parks, Recreation, and Forestry. So that would be on page C36. So, as we mentioned, adding the operations of buildings and grounds to the parks budget would take place during this next year. So Todd would be responsible for assuming some of those duties and using parks workers to help out with some of those duties. One of the things that we will have is an impact to the budget as we create lead worker positions. What we'd like to do is take advantage of the concept of the lead worker, which would free up the supervisor to do more day-to-day planning. There'll be some increased expense for that. There will be some increased administrative assistance for the building supervisor, so there'll be a little more responsibility taken on there, but we think we're in good shape. But there will be a process here next year to find out what we need help with. And then their Parks, Recreation, and Forestry, one of their biggest issues is the increasing operational expenses for an aging infrastructure. So as we look at whether we have 40-year-old bleachers at the Carson Park baseball stadium, on the football stadium, or the irrigation system, or the roadways, in any of our parks as things continue to get older and older. Within the parks maintenance, within operations, one of the things that we've recently learned is the Half Moon Lake water quality is better. It continues to improve, but it's not going to be a one-and-done Band-Aid fix with Alamo herbicide. You know, we're starting to find out from the technical team that does the work there that the alum will probably be a chemical that will be needed to be added periodically. I remember 5 years ago, or 6 years ago, when we did the first alum treatment, we all held out hope that there would be a one and done. That we would apply alum one time to the lake and it would bind up the phosphorus from the sawdust and would be done with it. Well, that didn't work out that way. We are going to, because the alum crystallizes, what we found out last week is the alum is crystallizing as it ages and it's not as effective as binding phosphorus. So we need to add a small layer to certain areas of the lake every 3 to 5 years. So our budget reflects changes in that. The herbicide, even though curly leaf pondweed was difficult to find this year, we all know that it's a plant that could come back with a vengeance. So we will continue to put out herbicide. And probably we'll have to for quite some time. We have, the parks also has increased operational maintenance funds, or we'll need funds to address a growing park system. We now have Jeffers Road online. We're gonna have the Confluence Park online here shortly. The Cannery District has considerable park acreage associated with that. That's going to have an impact on the Parks Department. So down the road, we need to respond to that with appropriate budget increases. We mentioned the operational expenses related to the aging infrastructure, our stadiums, our park shelters. We have a good chunk of those 177 buildings that we talked about before. A good chunk of those are within the park system. And then, as we mentioned before, we'll have wage increases due to the creation of Service Worker 3, the lead worker concept, as those positions become more and more used. So we'll have those at Carson Park, and we'll have those at Jeffers Road Park.
Phil, yes. On like Jeffers Road out there, we get some additional revenue, though, from the softball teams and this to help pay for some of that maintenance, right?
They're reimbursing us for a substantial portion of the operational cost, but not all of it.
Okay, but I mean that they are contributing.
They are contributing through the fees and buffet, just like Babe Ruth, Little League, soccer, all the existing groups, the way the Express, Cavaliers, and everyone pays fees for the work that we do. Okay. So we do recover some of it. In forestry, our most cherished division, forestry is hedges.
Oh my!
It is. Well, you just ask him. You know?
How much did Tom pay you to say that?
We exist for forestry. Yes. Everyone here would agree. That's our.
Everyone in
the
division.
City
forester is
an eye. It's our forest. Right. It's the sun. It's everything. So with EAB, with Emerald Ash Borer getting closer and closer, it's virtually surrounded us. It's not quite in Chippewa or Dunn County, but it's getting closer. You know, we feel very, very prepared for it. But there are still some things that we need to do. We are in a partnership now with a private vendor for the operating of the brush site. And we're in the first year. We're evaluating it. And what we found is that there might be some stresses associated with that partnership. The price of gas has gone down, which makes hauling brush to further distances less expensive. We've also found that the price that people who buy biofuels for heating their facilities, the quantities have gone up because of Emerald Ash Borer, and the price has gone down. So it may not exactly be a good partnership for a business. So we need to be prepared for the possibility that we need to get back into the brush business, especially with the Emerald Ash Borer. It's been a good thing to have this, to try this private public partnership with the Brush site. And we're learning a lot from it. There are a lot of advantages and a lot of, there are some disadvantages. And we'll have a better idea as the year goes on. Maybe things will change next year if the price of gas increases, if the price that, that vendors are willing to pay for biofuels goes up, then it's a whole different ballgame. So that's one of the things we need to be prepared to, is what if a private vendor said, there's not enough money in this, and they walked away from it, we would be heavily in the business. So we'd have to be looking at a tub grinder and a scale and somehow trying to recover our costs for hauling brush to the brush site.
Is that ever something that we would consider subcontracting to a private vendor that may be more cost-effective than something we could do ourselves or to make it?
We could. I think initially Todd's probably found that we could, if we bought that equipment, we could probably do it at a more reasonable cost, plus we could do it. We could do the grinding when we needed it. And, you know, I know Todd don't have a comment on that.
Yeah, the concern is right now what the cost of natural gas versus biofuel, with the paper mills and energy plants can burn natural gas far cheaper than they can convert the biofuel. And as the biofuel supply, the biomass supply is stuck, you know, higher and higher, the market is dwindling. And I think that's going to, that's a cause of stress on the trying to, in the private sector, turn a profit. It's, we're seeing that outside of being the relationship we have is going well. But I know, as Phil said, that this is our first year. And we're going to need a little bit of time to evaluate that. Should that trend continue where prices of natural gas are far less than biofuel, we'll have a community problem. We're going to have to figure out solutions to deal with it. And I do know that we can, the cost of wood processing equipment is high. But in turn, we could operate, own and operate, considered cheaper than hiring out. That it was almost a breaking point, but the critical point for us is this limited space we have. With biomass coming into that site, we need to have an avenue for biomass going out equally, because in the green waste that's coming is wonderful for the community too. Residents have an avenue to get rid of grass clippings and leaves. We can convert that to compost, things like that, much like box sanitation is doing on site. That 4-acre site, it'll reach carrying capacity very, very fast if we want to wait to get product off site to an energy plant or a paper mill or something like that. That's the critical issue.
If we converted it back to a city-owned operation, would the fees we charge to the citizens for bringing brush and stuff out there be similar to what it is to the private vendor, or how would that be done?
I think it'd be fairly similar. Perhaps maybe a little higher, but my initial glance at the vendor that is operating out there now, the structure he put together, I thought was really generous. I really do. I questioned if it would.
Okay. The reason I asked that question is some of the citizens said, wait a second, we used to get this free years ago, now there's a fee. And so my response kind of was, well, if we went back and it becomes city owned, there probably would be a fee.
Yeah, there certainly would be. And not to profit, but just as much as possible as we can endure without impacting the residents in a negative
way. Sure. And it was free in the past because of the state funded recycling through the county, so it wasn't necessarily.
Well, that's right. I forgot about that. But
it was a backstory. Yeah.
If we had a bigger site, and the company, say we don't have a company that's taking the biomass, if we had a bigger site, could we integrate composting and the chipping into one facility? Does that work?
It would take a little more.
But those two things come together, though.
But we are doing that on a small scale there now. But you're right, a larger site, so you could turn over the compost.
Because weren't we hauling a whole lot of leaves and grass and those type of materials out to the landfill last year?
That was two years ago when they were hauling it from.
That was the
county brought up boxes and then they were hauling them out to 7 Mile.
And that's not happening anymore.
No, because the cost at 7 Mile wanted for hauling those boxes, and then there was so much quantity that those boxes could keep up with.
That's what I mean, is if we were to do that in-house, possibly with the county, maybe we would be able to long-term think about using both the green and browns to make our own compost.
Yeah, we would agree that some kind of involvement from the county would be a good thing. Recycling in the city from yard waste.
It was a year ago, we were fortunate to have an agreement with the private
sure.
To give it a look.
Okay.
As the annual dashboard hits a clear, is that going to increase our budget or increase our expenses dramatically? Or you said that you've been preparing for that, but how is that going to affect operations?
Well, it's going to impact our operations immensely. What we're probably going to see is a number of other projects that take a back seat, because what happens with emerald ash is the ash trees will die within a 3 to 5 year period of time. And the problem that many communities had that weren't prepared is the trees were dying and they were falling over on people and cars and other property. They weren't getting them taken down quickly enough. We know that's we're not the first ones to have to deal with this. We know that the problem is you need to get those trees down and get ahead of it right away. What I would see happening is the forestry division would be greatly supported by the streets division and probably any other labor, kind of like when we have a snowstorm. Everybody drops what they're doing and helps out with the plowing, and we get it done. And emerald ash borer won't be too dissimilar to that. We're going to need to get those trees down, get them to a brush site, get them shipped, get them hauled away. But we feel really good about, we did a master plan in preparation of this 10 years ago now already. And we've been doing preemptive ash removal, so we've been removing ash in advance. It's been pretty much a voluntary program. In most of the community, when we do street projects, if there's ash, we just take it off. We're not even going to be asking about that. You know, we're also planting more species of trees to avoid this down the road. So not only impacting sidewalk issues with boulevard trees, but also trying to avoid a diverse species in the urban forest.
We have the trees inventoried, and I think during that period when we are more focus on taking them down, you'd also see some reduction in the regular maintenance that we provide to the urban forest. Would be, some of that.
Pruning.
Some pruning would be delayed.
We'd kind of push for a couple of years.
Yeah. And that's the problem with the emerald ash borer, is it's going to sag the trees to such a degree that we have to be conscientious between the other programs going on, planting program or maintenance program. Looking back at the, turning back the calendar several years, Elm disease, it's a community problem. Homeowners are losing trees in their private yards. We'll go back to a system where we oversee contractual removal. There's between 20 tree services up there. When we put those trees up, we send them, put that up on bid, and contractors get homeowner pricing, get rid of the trees, and hopefully they take a shorter period of time rather than 30 years of Dutch elm disease.
Anything else on forestry?
I told the forestry the world was
yeah.
I have a question on the recreation. We talked about increased number of public recreation spaces such as confluence or cannery, etc. What do you envision will be the future for staffing needs as responsibilities increase and assuming the municipal retirement title age affects all areas? How do you see that, I guess, taking care of the needs?
Well, 2 weeks ago, Todd and I were at a national conference and we looked at robots that mow parks. We looked at robots that line soccer fields, baseball fields.
Not a joke.
Using GPS. No, it's a little, looks like a, not much bigger than a push golf cart. Loaded up with paint and it's got a GPS on it. And they're very, very expensive. They're only used in Denmark right now. So once they get the budget worked out, but seriously, I think down the road, not in my lifetime certainly, but there's going to be a lot of parks maintained by robots.
Let's do a robot policy right now.
We have a drone supervisor. but the point is that we're going to see more and more technology is going to be used to help with that, those maintenance items. And also we're going to have to do a better job of planting species of trees and plants and the amount of grass that we have so it's easier to mow. So we're not creating incredibly labor-intensive parks. So I think that's what we're going to see down the road to deal with. This increased demand for parks.
I thought I saw a survey that you guys did recently, a community survey.
Yes.
About that. And are you addressing that? I thought I saw that there was sort of a need or a want for, probably a want for more like neighborhood programs. Mm-hmm. And I know I've had a couple of people who wasn't in your survey, I don't think, that talk about splash pads and stuff like that. Do you think you're doing going
back? Yeah, I was going to talk about that a little while later, but I think what we learned from this survey is that people kind of want to go back to the way it was. Mm-hmm. When we had neighborhood playgrounds and everybody had a summer playground program and the ice skating rink. I think we're seeing a trend to go back to that, which is, to me, is really refreshing because throughout my career we saw people go away from that and they wanted sport specific programs. My kid had to be in hockey. He was going to be in hockey 12 months a year. They were going to pick basketball at age 6 and they were going to specialize in that. And we saw a big trend towards that. We saw a trend towards kids having to have uniforms and umpires for every 6-year-old baseball game they ever played. And now it's very refreshing to see this might be the start of going back to that old way of kids being kids and not needing uniforms and fancy fields to play on. So I that's what I learned from this year. I thought it was a very interesting survey.
I skate on the Democratic skating rink every year, so I really appreciate that. But I was going to ask, have we ever looked into other grass species that take less water and maintenance? There's so many, and they're not all as lush as what we have, but are there any that are comfortable?
That our customers willing to accept.
Right.
Okay. So moving on to community services, recreation. One of the big issues that Dawn worries about is the minimum wage increases. If our entry level employees are lifeguards, we're paid $15 an hour. For example, if they were bumped to that rate, that would have a $300,000 impact on our budget, if that could increase. So we're very cautious about the effects of that on a future budget. Recreation is also concerned about the age of equipment, mechanical infrastructure, and aging facilities, kind of the same story that other divisions have concerns about. And then our most recent survey results, which are different from the national survey that was done, I think through ICMA. Mm-hmm. But what we found here is that people wanted more trails, and they had to have them sooner than later. Very stark contrast. Many of you remember when Brian Amundson was publicly chewed out for building a trail from Short Street to and at the end of his career, he couldn't build them fast enough, and that hasn't changed. In here, people love their trails in Eau Claire, and they can't build them fast enough. We also found that they want to see us go back to the neighborhood playground and ice skating concept, so kind of a return to the past. And then the one third thing that I thought was interesting in the survey is there was interest in a multi-purpose space for meeting and parties. So to me, this is like a four-season, a low-cost, low-rental charge for some kind of four-season meeting space. So again, the cannery could be a great spot for something like that, or something close to Fairfax Pool is probably something that the department should look at down the road. Any questions on the recreation budget?
Yeah, because that's the issue of wages is something we're probably going to tackle in a few months. Did you guys do any other considerations, like on a lower amount? I know the county started in with an increase. Like I think it was a 12-15 beginning and then ramping up. Did you do some other calculations?
I can have that in case
No worries.
We put together a request from you, and actually last year. We looked at raising to our minimum right now at 775 minimum.
Yeah.
We go to 875. So maybe we should look at as increment that.
Yeah.
And we looked at $10 an hour and $15 an hour.
Right. Because I know the counties was in between something like 1250 at the start and 2017, and then ramps up for five years. Something like 75 cents a year or something.
Okay. Okay. Because of the sheer number of part-time people that we hired, which are mostly high school or college students, it's all part-time wages. I would say, I don't know if you want to jump at 10 or 15 right away, but I can tell you that, for example, lifeguards, we might have to look at an increase just specifically there, because that's national trying to cross the board. Everybody's having trouble finding lifeguards, even though we work with our school district to have classes and things like that. So we look at different ways to retain staff, and one thing we're going to have to look at is a wage increase at some level.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, the next item in the budget is community services, utilities, so that would be water, sewer, and stormwater, so that's on page F1.
Before we move ahead, if I may, I see that in here aquatic recreation is Fairfax Pool part of the recreation program, or is there a budget?
There's another budget specifically for that coming up.
That'll be coming up in a minute.
Yeah. As we saw recently, our stormwater collection system has kept up with a lot of storms recently. I think the city has done a really great job of planning for that. As I mentioned before, we've done a lot of master planning within the utilities, and also completed the wastewater facility. I think congratulations are in order to Jeff Pippinger and Steve Hayden for making that project happen. It was a huge project that happened on time and with a minimal number of change orders. It's almost unheard of to have a project that size, a $40 million project, happen with so few change orders and issues, and really changed over very seamlessly. So I'd like to thank Jeff and Steve for all the work that they did in that project. So the wastewater remediation is complete, and staffing levels have been reduced. Jeff could answer any questions you have on that. Jeff mentions that his three big issues are still aging infrastructure with water collection and water distribution. Still a lot of old pipes in the ground. The existing amenities include a water plant that dispenses 24 million gallons per day capacity, 15 groundwater wells, 6 reservoirs, 379 miles of distribution system, 339 miles of wastewater collection system, less a couple feet than the Clare River, 24, well actually it's increased, just taking a long way there. The storm lift stations, and then 250 miles of storm system and inlets. It's also a note that Jeff was successful in acquiring or will be acquiring a grant for lead service line replacement through Wisconsin DNR. Be a program where we'll fund up to $1,000 the cost of that. So as you know, we're responsible for getting water to the curb stop, and then from the curb stop into the actual tap is the responsibility of the homeowner. So there's still, there might not be lead in our pipes in the water, but there still could be lead between the curb stop and a drinking fountain, for example. So part of this funding will be to replace that from the curb stop to the meter.
I mean, do we really have no good way of keeping track of that, do we?
On the private side?
On the private side, we do not have a good way to track that. We have a pretty good database for the main to the curb stop, but what happens on the other side of curb stop is not, we don't know necessarily when somebody is up. We may know if we've replaced it up to the curb stop when we're doing a street reconstruction, and and we know that they've taken it up to the house, but then that still doesn't help us know what happens inside the house. And then you also have the issue of you can have lead-based pipes or not have lead-based pipes. You could have copper, but you could have copper that lead solder. And you may or may not know about that. So that's where it's important for the homeowner, to have a professional come in and give that analysis if that's something they want, to have checked out within their house. Yeah.
Oh, can I ask a question on that lead pipes?
Yeah.
Do we know when that program is going to be online, developed?
We're in the process of creating our policy and getting the information that the DNR requires. Currently, we're going out for RFQs for qualified plumbers. Mm-hmm. Once we have that information back, we will have to decide on a date that will close on the. It's considered a loan, but it's a grant that will be offered to the city. We'll decide on that date. We're pushing for January 1st, so it makes it a little seamless. After 3 year commitment for that.
And then how homeowners apply, has that already been?
Yes, that's to be developed. Well, finished.
Well, we're working.
We're on the paperwork in the process.
And we're working with finance and inspections on how that process will go. So there will be a form that the property owner will fill out for plumber for the verification that it was a lead service line, and also inspections for the culture.
That's one more follow up. If a homeowner applies for that and got $1,000, how much is it off of, or how much does it normally cost to do the entire thing for a homeowner? Is it like $4,000 or $5,000 or?
No, we believe that $1,000 should cost.
Oh, really?
Cover most of that cost.
In a typical situation.
In most cases, there won't be much extra. But they'll have an option because it is a private property issue. Mm-hmm. We're going to give them a list of qualified plumbers they can get a quote from. And they can go with whoever they want. Mm-hmm. So if they have a friend that works for XY Plumbing, they want to go with them, but they're going to charge them $1,200, but they could go with somebody else that would say $900. It would be up to the property.
Sure. Thank you.
I can see that the budget analyst position is going to be very helpful to them in the community services division. And we saw that you're paying a quarter of it out of the general fund and community services, and then I see now sewer, water, and central maintenance makes up the full position. But what's the budget amount?
I can get that for you. I have the breakdown.
That's all right.
Trying to think of what spreadsheet I have it in.
Well, I don't need it now then. I'm
okay.
We'll
get that for you.
And then I know you've said this 30 times, but when does this start?
June, right?
June 1st, I think.
So it's like 6 months into the 2017. And where are is this position coming from?
Say that again?
I think it's new. Is this an added position?
Yes, this will be a new position to the position control.
Okay.
Do you want to
know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Question.
Yeah, got it.
Question about the wastewater treatment plant. Can we burn biochip? Can we burn biomass there?
Can we burn it? We do utilize the sludge and digest it.
Can we use the wood chips?
Wood chips. There's no wood chips. It's sludge.
No, I know, but could we utilize if we, does that, could that facility take wood, excess wood chips?
Not the way it's designed.
Not the way it was built.
We run off of nothing, yes.
Some places do that.
Yeah, you could, if you have the right perfect or something.
So, moving on to the parking fund, page F7. Parking fund is not a formal utility, but it's financially set up to look like one, walk like one, talk like one.
And Phil, not to, don't mean to interrupt, but we have put processes in place to be able to account for this as a utility would be accounted for starting the first of the year. So the police department will, when they're doing parking enforcement, the parking enforcement personnel will track their time against the parking enforcement activity. We haven't done that in the past. They just charge their time to the police department and don't track how much time they spend on parking enforcement versus other activities. We'll be doing the same thing with our engineering staff, and we'll also be tracking revenues a little bit differently so that we'll be able to associate all of the downtown parking revenue, as well as the fine and forfeiture revenue, with that parking, with that parking fund, as opposed to it just being general fund revenue. So our goal is to be able to say, hey, this is how much it costs to do downtown parking, our downtown parking activities, and this is how much revenue we take in from the downtown parking activities. So we've set up those processes and that account structure in our general ledger to be able to do that.
We're a little bit worried about, we were at one time, maybe we're sort of getting over it, but a little bit worried about fines, incentivizing the fine structure for forfeiture.
Yeah, but
we're not going
to
do that.
No, we're not creating a utility. All we're doing is creating mechanisms to be able to track that information. So if we have questions, we can answer the questions.
I'm really glad to see that. And I'm thinking that's sort of new, and I'm hoping that we can tweak it just a little bit on some things, but I'm really glad to see that we're moving in that direction where we can kind of keep track of it a little bit better. I don't see any in here. I don't see any projected revenues for 2016 or 17 at all on the ramps or anything like that.
The new ramp, the majority of the revenue, or three quarters of the revenue off the new ramp, is actually going into the TID. One quarter of it, or one floor of the ramp, is revenue into the parking fund.
Okay, that makes sense. We can talk about that.
The other parking utility, as we mentioned, the ramp across the street has some aging issues. There was an engineering study done on it. We're now getting a second opinion on the diagnosis of the lifespan of that facility. But that's it was built to be a 50-year-old facility, and it's probably about what it's going to last. And it's at 43, 44 years old right now. So it's going to have a major impact parking in the downtown area. So just when you thought you were over the hump, there's always another challenge out there.
And we'll have future discussions about this.
Moving on to the Hobbs Ice Center, page F11. Again, the preventive maintenance schedule that we've changed to, rather than the reactive maintenance, has been a big plus for that facility. It still is a 40-year-old facility, or 35-year-old facility that has issues. So, we're going to need to replace the floor at an aggregate rate, but as we saw, the stakeholders are willing to pay for it for the ice time, and we've also seen the increased economic impact of that facility and what it has on the community. And it, you'll see Dawn in the future here address that in the future budget. Any questions about Hobbs?
Could I make one comment that I sort of forgot to make when you talked about streets? You talk about this maintenance that you're doing now to maintain and stuff. I noticed on Hastings Way and some of the other streets in town, they've been doing a much better job of maintaining that. I saw people out there pressure washing the concrete, sealing the concrete, the plants and plantings and stuff all look really good. I just want to comment on that, that I've noticed that we're maintaining our facilities to a nice degree.
That's Steve's group.
Good job.
Fairfax Municipal Pool is on page F13. We did some major upgrades to the pool filter building about, it's probably been 5 years ago now, and that's been a huge plus. The facility is well maintained. We do have a request from a citizen that Councilor Klinkhammer can talk about a little bit. It's a request for free senior citizen access to water aerobic classes, if not other activities at Fairfax Pool. That is not in the budget. As we understand the request, it would have about a $10,000 impact on the budget. So, Dave, if you want to talk about the request.
It was a request that came to me through from a gentleman by the name of Jim Marchese, who was very instrumental in the providing the impetus to have the pool built in the first place. And being of an age where I'd be automatically, it got my attention. But I talked to Dale about it, and I talked to Phil about what the economic impact it would have, the budgetary impact it would have. It's the first number I've heard, first time I've heard it. I think it has merit. I think that as we promote a healthy community, to provide a mechanism for seniors to participate. I'm sorry that Jackie Pavelski isn't here. She was harping on that for years. But I think it's an issue worth looking at.
Are those classes already being held? And the costs would come from the scholarships?
We don't have enough coming in our scholarship fund.
Yeah.
So that's part of the problem.
We do currently have classes for several years now, at least three. We had a grandparents day on Tuesdays where people that are grandparents, doesn't matter how old you're a grandparent, you can bring your grandchildren in free. Well, we've been doing that on Tuesdays. We also have season passes, which are another way to get a discount, and then we do have scholarships.
The classes, though, like water aerobics, are those classes already happening?
Those classes are already happening.
Okay. And so the $10,000 would be?
Those are indoor classes. We're talking about Fairfax outdoor pool.
So there are no water aerobics happening at Fairfax Pool?
Yes, we have water aerobics in Lapstone, and that is part of the $10,000 impact on the budget.
But not occurring right now.
Okay.
Right, I'm just speaking on Fairfax Pool's behalf, so during while we're open, we do offer classes in the morning.
Okay. The request is that they're free.
I just was handed the letter that he, I asked him to send the letter so it was on the record. And I, Kathy just gave it to me tonight, and I read it and I gave it to Dale. But I don't know that the request is for free participation in all the programs. I thought it was just access to the pool that he was asking for seniors. So I don't know what the fee schedule is for water aerobics and that sort of thing, but it would seem reasonable that if we could start it on the program of possibly just gaining access to the pool and allow them the opportunity to participate at their own expense for the various activities. I don't know what the impact of that would be.
Well, it's all tied together right now. Okay. How we currently operate, that's what gave us the $10,000 number. We have to look at different ways to operate and have people, just how we manage traffic flow and that kind of thing. If we want to.
Don, to clarify, for the early morning aerobics classes, is there an additional charge above and beyond the entrance fee to attend? No. So the entrance fee
I mean, it's just a program that's there, and your entrance fee or your annual pass lets you come in and participate in the class.
Is that something you coordinate with the senior center somehow to, for them to help offset some of that?
We could coordinate with the senior center, but they're not necessarily the people that are coming to the pool, the therapist pool particularly. So, yes.
So that's something we can definitely look at for a future year. Maybe it's just going to need a little more study than what we decide tonight. Perhaps some involvement from waterways, some input from them.
Well, I think it's an idea that has merit and should be looked at.
And I will say, just as a side note, we did go to the national conference not a couple weeks ago, and we did look into these types of things, and we had conversations, and it really is a national trend not to do this counting for many populations, including seniors. So there's some, like Phil said, more study than you require.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item we have is community services, central equipment. So it's on page G3. This is the division within streets that maintains our fleet. Very important as we've gone through significant budget issues over the last 10, 12 years. One of the ways that we've made our budget make ends meet is to extend the life of our fleet and not necessarily increase the maintenance budgets for those items. So again, we're shifting away from that, and we think that within the next 4 to 5 years we can be caught up, and we can be replacing squat cars and other snow plows and other vehicles in a more timely manner. PD seems to be in pretty good shape now. They have the fleet that they need, and squads are being replaced in a timely manner. Again, their biggest issue is the number of bays and mechanics to work in as we continue to add pieces of equipment, puts more demand on the need for mechanics.
And I think we mentioned this earlier in the budget process, but we did increase vehicle rental rates. I believe we increased them 2% this year as part of about a 7-year strategy, so we can get back up to speed on the replacement of equipment. What we've been finding is that as we held the replacement dollars constant, we weren't able to replace equipment in a timely manner, and the maintenance costs went up, and it kind of created this cycle where as maintenance costs went up, we had less dollars to replace equipment, and it just kind of keeps going. So we're trying to increase the rates that we charge users of the equipment through the rental rate, so that we can get that replacement done in a more timely manner.
Okay, moving on to community services transit, page F9. Kind of the same thing. The bus fleet is getting old, and it's getting more expensive to keep in service. We have not received dollars from the state or federal government to keep up with replacing buses. We have a fleet of 22 buses. We should be replacing them with an average lifespan of 12 years. We should be replacing about 2 buses per year. And we are lucky to do 1 a year. So what we've had to do is we've had to get into the used bus business. We've been buying buses from Duluth, Rochester, and most recently Indiana University. We have a couple used buses. And that's what we're going to have to do until funding from the state and federal levels improves, or we start to use general funds to somehow fund purchase of buses, which would be a big bite. Our transfer center has served its purpose well, but it's too small to meet our current daily demand. It was built for 8 buses an hour. We currently have 10 buses an hour and 12 buses at afternoon peak. We have a portable restroom out there in front of the facility. Continual repairs to heating and air conditioning and roofing are almost needed. Our maintenance cost requires more work to be contracted out to local providers in order to keep up Sometimes we need to contract out our buses. Now we have buses from Rochester and Duluth and Indiana University and all different makes and models, and that puts more stress on the mechanic because sometimes they may not be used to working on a particular bus that has that engine or that type of wheel. So we need to contract it out. So it does cause problems to go with this used bus philosophy. 95% of the population of Eau Claire and Altoona is within a quarter mile of a fixed bus route, which is very admirable. It's a challenge to maintain, especially as the city spreads out. Tom thinks it would be an excellent selling point if we could offer a fixed route to the potential distribution center that Mr. Schatz is working on. And perhaps getting people to and from that a site like that would be beneficial and attractive to the last transit development plan recommended improving frequencies of routes to make the service more serviceable to citizens, whether that's half hour or 20 minute frequency, comes with a price tag. There are still many pockets of potential service areas that are not reached, Menards West for employment, CBTC, Gateway Campus for education, and the new developments in the Altoona area. You know, we quite often get requests from Altoona or from Eau Claire riders on how to get to Woodlands. Any questions for
I do have a question that has very little to do with the budget, but those changes that we made to space for bus stops, the parking impact that it had on removal of parking spaces. Has there been any pushback on any of that? Or has it helped the drivers?
It's helped. And we've been very responsive. When we address the issue in areas where there have been critical need, where people are having difficulty getting boarding, and then we end up, an example is on the north side, the homeowner called us to say, is there any other alternative here? And we were able to work out a solution with them. So we're responsive to the citizens when they bring up if it's caused a problem there.
Thank you.
Very good.
Okay.
Okay.
Has the city ever looked at perhaps the equation it would take for us to start paying for our own buses without having to do general fund because of an increase in choice ridership versus a system that's currently heavily transit dependent ridership? Is there a sweet spot predictive scale that we have?
One of the things, if we look at our system nationwide, it's a the nationwide average for systems our size, comparable systems, is like 10 passenger trips per capita. And ours is at 13. You know, so I think what that tells us is that we're getting more than just transit-dependent ridership. We're getting other types of riders, you know, because even a movement of a tenth of a percent or a tenth of a passenger trip per capita is a huge movement. So being being above the national average at three is very significant. So I'm not sure that other than maybe trying to tap into like the millennial community, that especially with the Jamf being located in the downtown area, I think there's a lot of people that would use public transit to go there if we changed our services slightly to meet their needs. So what that would cost in terms of attracting ridership, I don't know that we have done a study on that, but it's something we could look into, especially when we do an external development plan.
It seems that given the reality that we're not receiving the types of funding from the state and the feds, which has been, you know, same song, same sad song, unfortunately, and that
even the acquisition abilities have changed, so the buying power is different. It seems we're going to have to be self-sufficient. We can't hold our breath for, unfortunately, other levels of government and be responsive at the same time. So.
What we've always been dependent on is 80% match of the federal government. There's never been a Wisconsin capital system, so we've been dependent on that. So you would be looking at increasing our costs by that amount. I'm just throwing out a rough average of a 40-foot bus, about $450,000. So we're looking at $900,000 every year for capital purchase, roughly, sometimes less, and we'll receive funding of about $250,000.
I think it would be advantageous at some point in time. Tomorrow would be great, but tomorrow would be great for a lot of things. But just to look at just some different scenarios of it, if we continue what we're doing now, and then if we want to reach out to this population and, just kind of create some scenarios so that we can think, the city could be thinking about, and this is how we'd like to accommodate and grow public transportation, and here's a pathway how we could do it. I think that would be very much worth looking at, especially with our new transit center coming on in the next 5 years or so.
Anything else on transit?
I have a question. So the university contracts with the city, is that right?
Correct.
And is that revenue included in the charges for services category?
It should be in
Okay. I'm not sure if that's the line it's in or not, but it's in the it's within the transit budget.
Okay. They pay an annual cost for student ridership, and then there's also a portion of it that covers capital costs.
Okay. And then the national average that you spoke of, does that include data for the university buses as well?
Yeah. That's a comparing, taking systems that have like a university community dollar same size.
The university students, that really saved our bacon, doesn't it?
Definitely back in the mid-90s when the discussions were happening, yeah. That contract with the university was very key in helping improve the system.
What is our number of passengers per year roughly now?
It's roughly, I think last year was just over 900,000, and it had been over a million. There has been a trend with the fuel prices going down. There has been a trend of ridership going down that's been across the state of Wisconsin, too. But still, our efficiencies are above the national average. And above you and our Wisconsin peers were about in the average, around the average we're on at for Wisconsin.
So if we tried to fund our two buses a year, we'd have a significant fee increase.
If you wanted to try to pick that up through fares, yes.
It would be around the buck.
You would see a decrease in ridership. You don't get the increase in revenue by raising your fares that you would expect.
Right.
You see a decrease in ridership that reduces that amount of revenue, and it takes you over time to pick that up.
Councilman Mitchell, just to elaborate on your, likely the expanded and evening service would not have happened without the partnership that we were able to enter into with the university.
Mm-hmm. That was Charlie Mom's idea. He's not here. Nobody knows
him. Other transit questions?
What is, on the transit center itself, we got the proposal looking at it. How is federal funding looking for matching grants now? Is that?
The more we put into it, the better it will be. That's what I've been told. If the more the city is willing to put into these types of projects, the more competitive you are in receiving federal funds.
So are you saying then that if the transit center would cost $5 million, we'd put in $2.5 million, we'd have a much better chance of getting $2.5 million? Or
much,
whatever?
Much better, yes.
Yeah. Okay. But
I don't think it would need to necessarily be that drastic, but yeah.
Okay. So the proposals are very competitive.
Yes. If you keep with the standard
same proposal, then, and you got two different
80-20
proposals, and one saying the city will put up 30%, the other saying the city will put up 20%. The 30% obviously is going to be more competitive.
Okay, thank you.
I'm seeing zero on their intergovernmental revenue. Is that, are we not receiving any money from the state or the federal government?
No, we receive substantial money from both the state and the feds. Is it in non-operating revenues in that $3.5 million?
Well, the bulk of our revenue is from the state.
Yes.
Passengers pay a relatively small portion of it.
Passengers in Wisconsin pay, on average, 13%. In the city of Eau Claire, it's 18%.
Okay.
Other transit-related questions?
Okay, Pamela.
Well, thank you. I thought I would begin by saying that we should dispel the myth that the library is boring, a warehouse of books, and that there's nothing for me there. And that's irrelevant in today's world. There is something for everyone and for all ages. We help people connect, succeed, innovate, research, and transform. Our customers can play, grow, read, learn, and create. The library's mission is to promote lifelong learning, create creative spaces and collaborative spaces, support open access to diverse materials and resources to enhance the quality of life in the community. In 2015, the community and library staff and board engaged in a strategic planning process, and goals that came out of that were to provide the best user experience possible, to optimize library spaces to better serve community needs, to foster a culture of creativity and innovation, to engage customers through community-based services and partnerships, and to raise awareness of how the library contributes to the quality of life in the community. As librarians and library workers, we abide by a code of ethics. We protect the privacy of our customers and defend the First Amendment. We provide fair and equitable access to information, services, and materials, regardless of race, color, sex, national origin, age, religion, sexual orientation, or disability. Our staff is our most valuable asset. Including part-time workers, the library employs 69 individuals and 45 full-time employee equivalent. We are continually hiring, onboarding, and training. For example, we expect all our reference librarians and staff to be able to assist customers with digital downloads from all mobile devices. And as you know, that changes almost daily. So keeping up with that is quite a challenge. We strive for exceptional customer service, including emergency assistance training. And I received, I thought it was rather timely, an email from a patron whose wife had a low blood sugar diabetic incident in the library, and he wrote to say how grateful he was for the staff and their training and the humanity that they possess. So that was timely. The library positions were not included in the salary analysis that the rest of the city staff partook in, and so our pay plan is not reflective of that, so we'll be working towards that. That was before I came, and the staff then elected not to take part in that. We invest in technology to improve staff efficiencies and to create opportunities for customers. For instance, the public can submit online job applications, conduct job searches, and advance career goals. They can learn new skills through instructional videos through lynda.com and access authoritative electronic resources and research genealogy and learn new languages. As customers, you can manage your library accounts online 24/7. You can download music, audiobooks, ebooks, films, and digital magazines. The Ellie Phillips Memorial Public Library is a neutral space, a place to meet, collaborate, and connect with others. It is the most visited facility with a daily count, or downtown facility, and has a daily visitor count of more than 1,200 people. That's per day. The public facilities and public spaces in a city help determine the identity of the city it serves. A safe and well-maintained and modern library reflects positively on the city, and the state of the library often influences potential residents and is an economic driver for the community. Going into 2018, the library's CIP projects will be funded through the city's CIP budget and not from the library's operating fund balance. This is new. Instead, the fund balance will be used for one-time purchases that support the achieving the goals of our strategic plans. In 2016, already this year, we have received several grants. The BA Mason Trust for $400 to Teen Technology, a Best Buy Foundation grant for a makerspace in the amount of $8,200, an Otto Bremer Foundation grant for furnishings in the amount of $55,000, and a state office energy grant for $75,000 for lighting retrofit. The endowment fund distribution for the book bike was $10,000, and that helped us to provide a library branch on wheels, provide library experiences that were unexpected to the community, showcase our digital content, and connect with users of all ages. New in our 2016 suite of services, we adopted the strategic plan, like I mentioned earlier. We installed a new reference desk with a smaller footprint, made Wi-Fi hotspots available to those without internet access, added a lucky day collection to improve access to high demand titles, expanded community partnerships such as the Spanish-English bilingual story times, and renovated the library space to create a makerspace for all ages, and that's currently underway. In 2017, we will be focusing on technology, infrastructure, and more. We need to not only increase access to Wi-Fi, but also upgrade our current equipment. We will install a print management system that will provide color copies and printouts for the public, as well as serving as a cost recovery. Right now, printing is free for the first 10 pages for our patrons, and we find that that's abused. And by providing a vendor unit would force the customers to make good decisions, and it's also a good green effort as well. Library trends across the nation have, as you know about Library 2.0, which is the move to digital shift in materials and services. We're also seeing what I've termed as Library 3.0. It's hands-on learning and virtual learning. It's more of an emphasis on classes, programs, events, and the electronic access, such as online videos. It's an emphasis on creating a place to feel and get connected. The other half of that is a design with purpose to accommodate a variety of learning styles and collaborative spaces. That includes performance spaces, meeting rooms and community kitchens, art studios, tech and science labs, makerspaces, welding and wood shops, recording studios, and shared workspaces. All in all, we have a few challenges. We discovered a structural crack in the large concrete retaining walls, and the pavement at the main entrance is uneven and a trip hazard, and there is also poor lighting at the front main entrance. There is no pedestrian walkway from the street level to the lower level parking and entrance, and these are safety concerns. We have a leaky roof, front doors that don't always lock, and our 40-year-old HVAC system has exceeded its lifetime. It is inefficient and requires repairs. The library parking space is inadequate and in violation of the Eau Claire County Ordinance 18.25.020. Let's move to indoor facility challenges. Interior, the water on the lower level is not fit to drink, and programming kitchen is not ADA compliant and not accessible. The carpet has exceeded its lifetime. It is worn and stained. The ceiling tiles are water stained from the water, the roof leaks, and are missing pieces, and the product is no longer available. The wood bookshelves are unstable, bowed, and a liability issue as well. Our space challenges can be addressed with what we are hoping to do, a space needs analysis. Right now, the library does not have a nursing room for mothers, and that is for public or on the staff side. Our library customers who experience sensory sensitivity need a dedicated place to decompress. Small group city study rooms are requested for various reasons, such as taking proctor tests, tutoring and collaborating on activities, interviewing via Skype and phone. More space is needed for youth services. That is my report. I want to thank you for supporting the learner, the artist, the innovator, the inventor, the actor, and the reader. Thank you.
Sounds like you need to start a capital campaign. What are you going to do about all the maintenance issues?
Right, so one of the initiatives that we have is to do a building feasibility study. So I didn't mention that. I meant to mention that that's part of our budget for the coming year. And that will help us set priorities and determine costs and be able to strategize the next step. Yeah, the building is 40 years old, so some things have been kept up, some not so much.
Okay. So, yes. Well, regarding the staff and the pay plan, are you suggesting that you are going to do a compensation study then?
We have not talked about that as board, but we will need to do that as well. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Can you use data and dump it into the study that we did as a city? Is that possible?
Not, it won't tie in particularly well because it's a lot of it's based on survey data. And when the decision was made to not have the library be part of our study, the city didn't collect comparable library data, so it's not available.
I do have comparisons from other libraries across the state. We share that information as professionals, so I can tell you that we need to make some adjustments in certain areas.
Tell me about this change going from the capital projects, going from your budget to the city CIP.
Mm-hmm. So I don't know if it's always been this way, but the last decade in a way, the money was transferred from the city to the library board, and how that was spent was up to the library board. So all capital campaign, all operating funds were commingled, but it was the responsibility of the board to make those decisions. Do you want to explain any better than I, Jay?
No.
Okay.
You have to submit your CIP to our scrutiny.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And isn't there shared costs in the library between the city and the county, or is that right?
Yep. So the city versus county, well, city versus all other income is about 60-40. Is it?
Yeah, there's a formula that's been developed based on the county usage that the library gets reimbursed.
Right.
Pamela, well, thank you for sharing kind of the very good and the bad and the ugly. That's courageous and also necessary to talk about and address.
Yeah.
Can you share a little bit more about this parking conundrum?
Right. So in doing the little bit of research that I can, what's on, available online, it's I think the formula was 300 square feet to one parking space. And that the library fell under government buildings. And with the traffic that we have, that makes sense. What is considered library parking is not really clear to me at this point. I think some of our customers use the parking ramp. Some of them use the City Hall parking lot, though they're probably not supposed to.
You have a new parking administrator.
I was going to say that's all part of you know, the parking administrator, where we're going downtown. We'll also tie into the plaza, you know, the library plaza and that design. So we have a lot of parking discussions ahead of us.
Are the library employees still using the ramp for parking?
They are. The library and the city employees are still using the ramp.
Okay. And then you also use the lot across the road from there.
Right.
I thought we moved the city employees out of this.
No, that's the Haymarket. The Haymarket people were moved, not the city.
There was a 2-hour time period where that was.
Right. Anything else
Storm
for Pamela?
The Bastille.
Yeah. Anything else for Pamela in the library?
Well, thank you. Do I just have a quick question that is a large one, but it looks to me like the use, the accepted cultural norm for what a library is used for is under some tremendous flux.
Yes.
Do you think maker spaces are really a possibility that your board would contemplate as a capital investment?
Yep, so we're in the midst of renovating the library right now for our makerspace. The flooring was put in this last week, and we have equipment on order. We have a 3D printer, laser cutter, vinyl cutter, and a laser engraver, and computers and Lego lines, drawing kits, and so forth. So it will be focused on science and technology, engineering, art, and math. We have started our collaboration with Chippewa Valley Technical College to bring in some experts there and to do some training of our staff. And it's moving along so that I can see a grand opening in January, and you will all be invited to attend that. I think it's very exciting. I think it's much like in the 70s when we took shop and learned how to pigs out of wood for the
Mom's
cutting board. Yes. And we took home economics.
Made an apron.
There were sewing machines. same concept. We'll have sewing machines, we'll have knitting classes, you know, it'll be the whole gamut. And it's a trend. Some people say it's a trend, but I think it's here to stay. I think that there are so many people who learn from hands-on learning, their audio-visual. It's not just reading, we learn and through experiences as well. So it's very exciting time to be in libraries, and this shift will really, I can really see this affecting the community at large.
I think we're gonna need a bigger boat.
that makerspace, it seems like it absolutely embodies your purpose here, you know, mm-hmm. as written, and to a team.
Yeah.
How exciting.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, as Pamela stated at the very beginning, the concept of what a library means to the community, what it is changing dramatically. Mm-hmm. It has to keep one foot on the traditional role and move smoothly into whatever it's going to become. And we are fortunate to have Pamela helping us with that process. She's been a real asset, really. We're really pleased to have her.
Thank you.
We have a great board now. not my involvement in that. We have some really talented people in the way the board has transitioned over the last year. So.
And the staff is well equipped for making these changes as well. I'm so impressed with their enthusiasm and their flexibility. And that's how I see that that will be the hallmark of every librarian, is to be flexible and ready to learn a new skill or talent, and then be able to teach that, turn around and teach that to community members. So, well, all right, thank you.
Do you want to stand up, or should we do the whole thing standing up?
Let's do the hokey pokey.
Good. Happy 7 o'clock.
You're done.
So $5.6 million, you're done, right? So there you go.
That's all you need, right?
First of all, thanks for the opportunity and for staying this long. I appreciate it. It's 75 years since the health department has been the City County Health Department. You may feel right now, tonight, that you've been part of that for 75 years. You haven't, but your predecessors and you now really make that happen. So my thanks to all of you. It is unique. I don't know if everybody realizes that, but it is very, very unique, our relationship and arrangement, so thanks for that. I want to call out a couple of things related to the strategic plan for the City of Eau Claire, just as a reminder to you. All of you have your mission statement memorized, right? Yeah. Council President Kincaid, I'm sure, does.
Yeah.
No?
Oh, yeah. Right.
But
right?
It includes health.
But it includes health. It says safe, sustainable, engaged, and healthy community. So two things I want to call out about that. Mm-hmm. We work on all of those things at the health department, but two things specifically, engaged and healthy, obviously, community. Just to give you a little bit of feedback about those, so you can think about how the health department is working on that. Being engaged with our community and with our partners is core to what we do. It's been a really big push since I've been at the health department, but always true. Our community partners particularly count on us being engaged and connected to them. And we have that same relationship with our county peers in that county building, as well as our city peers. And it really is critical. I think one of the special things we bring to the table, though, is engagement with the population. So some of you have been involved in some of our projects. Eau Claire Healthy Communities is an example of that, the Cannery District Health Impact Assessment is another example, where we have really worked hard to get out to the community, to the population, especially those that are impacted in ways that are resulting in poor health, and getting their voice at the table and doing that in a really effective way. That's one of the strengths of the staff that I have at the department. So engagement, one of your mission statements. Healthy, I would just obviously call it too, because I think we bring to the city the science around what makes health, what the best practices are to change health, and a specific focus, obviously, on prevention. And you guys have all heard me say that over and over again, but really being able to step back and not wait until there are problems, but really prevent things before they start. You know, I'm sure all of you wore your seatbelt coming here, although Mr. Emerson walked, I noticed, just to call that out. I noticed that as I drove over here, but seatbelts. You all wear your seatbelts. We know from public health strategies that, again, talking to people about wearing seatbelts makes a difference, but a policy change, public health policy change, really assures that we have those things happen. One of the big changes in health department work, not dissimilar to the library, we're still doing all the old stuff we did. We follow up on communicable disease, but we're working on policy now, and we're really trying to make a difference around changing policy so that we have health improvement in community. So, a little overview about how I think specifically we connect to mission. A couple of the goals in the strategic plan I would just call out that we are particularly working on, and I would say, although Dale can contradict me, but I think we have modeled some things that we are doing at the health department that the city is also seen as a positive. So quality improvement is something that you know is in your strategic plan for the city as a whole. And some of what is built in the quality improvement objectives that you guys review is stuff that we started at the health department, having a core team, working on quality improvement projects, building a culture of quality. That stuff all sounds good if you kind of just do it, but if you're really working on quality and making it part of what how you do business, we build some efficiencies and effectiveness in our processes. So I would call out that that's something that we contribute. We also, workforce is a big strategic plan priority for the city. It also is for the health department. And just a couple of things that I would say that I think we're doing particularly well and staff are doing particularly well. We've really focused on training our staff, and we have an amazing group at the health department. But people like Shane have worked hard to get national level scholarships, free training for some of our staff to go not only be able to learn things, but to bring it back and work on new projects and focuses, but also to share the great things that are happening in Eau Claire. And I think that's something to call out. We're getting recognized for that. We also, around the workforce, have spent a lot of time and energy taking our 63 paid employees and getting work done with all kinds of people that are not paid. We have lots of work that we need to get done. And I'll just call it a couple of things. We just last month had Centers for Disease Control Public Health Associate start with us, a 2-year person that's coming from Centers of Disease Control. They are paying her salary and we get her full time. We've had for the last 2 years a full time person from UW-Madison, a master's prepared public health person that comes with lots of data experience. He's working for us, his salary's paid by UW. We're working really hard on those kinds of things. We have interns from UW-Eau Claire that are doing GIS work for us right now. We have someone that has developed amazing maps of all kinds of things because he brings expertise to the table. I can go on and on. AmeriCorps interns, AHEC, which is Area Health Education interns that have put, you know, not just the couple-hour project, but really substantive time and energy into some new and important work that the city is benefiting from. The last strategic plan area that I just want to call out is our work with technology. So we have a laboratory at the health department that if you haven't been to our health department, you should come and see. That lab is recognized by the state and CDC, the feds, as being a really strong public health lab. And we're using technology to help us get outcomes for public health. We have jumped full into GIS, as I've said, and we are really looking at how place makes a difference in health and used GIS technology. even little examples of use of technology. We have an environmental staff that has found online that it's not Craigslist, but a site like that where you sell stuff, people selling food products. Well, they're not licensed by us to sell food, but we found them through using technology to identify a problematic practice. Clearly, we don't want food sold to customers that isn't from a safe place. So all kinds of ways that we use technology to make a difference in the work. Do we have challenges in our budget and in our work? Absolutely. Many of them we're trying to turn into opportunities. Not all of them work. But I'll just call out a couple of things. We're working on revenue and expense issues every single day. And we have a really strong team. Janice is here. She helps work with our staff to really focus on what are our dollars coming in and how do we look at that creatively. Something that you may not know, but different than most of the city departments, about half of our budget is tax levy, city and county tax levy. The rest of it, we have to go out and find. Some of it is federal pass-through dollars that the state gives us. So immunization grant is an example of that. They give us dollars. But most of our money comes in as through fees and competitive grants. And we have grown that part of our budget substantially. So you'll see the increases in our budget. Those are all related to grants. Last year, the budget that you saw and the budget that we are now ending with, we've had $380,000 of new money coming in, all from competitive grants that have been written. So you've heard about some of those as you've approved them at the city council floor, but do know that that's a big challenge for us, is funding to do the work that has been prioritized, but we're working hard to find new opportunities to find ways to fund that. Flat funding is tough, and grant dollars to fill in for flat funding is hard because it means that we, all those core services, big, messy issues that the health department is dealing with and community partners are asking us to work on because they see value in us partnering, are tough. And so I would put those out as challenges that I don't think are surprising to you, but know that we recognize them as challenges and we're trying to find grant dollars right now to work on them. But things like opioid addiction. You heard me talk about that grant that we're working with the police department on, but methamphetamines we have no direct dollars for. We do have drug-free communities dollars to work on alcohol issues for youth, but not more broadly than that. So all of those messy ALDA issues, again, a big challenge. Mental health, again, we got some competitive grant dollars to work on mental health issues, but a enormous community problem. Health department could be part of solutions from a prevention standpoint. We know programs like Nurse Family Partnership, which is a very intensive home visitation program, evidence-based nationally for new moms and babies, works for mental health outcomes, child abuse outcomes. We don't have enough money to do it for very many people. It's an example of where we could make a difference in mental health, but we don't have the resources to do it. Poverty, homelessness, you know, environmental issues around housing. I could go on and on, obviously, and you guys know that I love to talk about those things and I'm passionate about them, but those are challenges that we're facing. One of the challenges that we are directly addressing in 17 is accreditation. So our health department is not nationally accredited. There has been a process available for a few years now, and we think we're ready to put ourselves forward to be nationally accredited. The board has approved moving that forward. It's going to be a lot of work in 17, but important. So do know that that's something on our list for 2017. I guess the last couple of general things I would say is that we know that there's a return on investment for prevention work. We can quantify that most of the time, not all of the time, but there's national work that has done that. Whether it's safe housing or vaccinations or safe water, we know that if we can prevent problems, we'll save money. We also know that partnerships are increasingly important, and our job is setting the table, I often say, and I think we've done a really great job of that, but we have a lot more work that needs to be done. I think there's not a clear understanding of how much time it takes to get partners around the table to agree on something and move it forward. So suicide prevention is an example that many of you may have seen the work that's been happening the last year around suicide prevention. Huge issue, increasing suicide rates, but a lot of work has been done to try and get partners to the table that maybe wanted to do their own thing to say, how can we tackle this collectively? Health department person leads the suicide death review team. Health department person leads the mental health action team along with community partners. I mean, that's all time and effort that is enormously costly, but enormously helpful. So I just put that out for you to think about. You know, how can we start investing on the front end so we don't have all these long-term costs in the back end? Partners want us to do that work. They really do. And, you know, paying for it is tough, going from grant to grant to grant to grant, which is what we're doing right now. Our budget for 17 is built on a proposed levy increase that you see both from the city and the county. We're appreciative of that. It doesn't cover our increasing costs, so I will make clear to you that the way I have to do that, if I want to keep staff, is to find other dollars. And that does mean stopping doing some of the things because our increases because of, you know, increase in step increases for salary, health insurance increases, WRS increases, you know, all of those things. That amounts to more than what we get with the tax levy increase. We have done a really focused job looking at our performance measures, looking at prioritizing our programs. We have stopped doing as intensely some things that don't give us as much bang for the buck, but those are hard choices. We don't use our capital purchases. We take out of our fund balance at the health department. We are not included in the capital purchases of the city, so just do know that. So any improvements that we need, whether it's a piece of lab equipment or some large, you know, we have offices that are from the 1960s, those are all come out of the health department fund balance and our capital improvements from that pot of money. We also, as Pamela indicated, the health department was not part of the city salary survey and compensation study. So we did one 4 years ago, and we are up for a new compensation study. So we are looking at ways, if we're able to with the budget, to do that in 2017. We also have spent a lot of time on fees. And if you look at the balance, and if anybody wants this, I can give you a quick, you know, summary of how our budget breaks down. Again, it looks different than what the overall city budget looks like. We have fee for services, about 10% of our budget. Licenses and permit fees is about 11%. So when you put that together, the fees that we try and bring in based on the cost of our services is a big focus of what we do for our budget. I think that is more than enough. Although I would say that I said to Shane I could talk about, you know, tick-borne diseases for as much time as you guys talked about ash trees, but I won't. Because tick-borne diseases has much bigger impact, I'll tell you.
On dogs and people.
Yeah, you know, hugely on people. Yeah. Our communicable disease rates is a huge challenge, are astronomically increasing, and I have Board of Health is going to be talking about that tomorrow, but we get no state funding for communicable disease. It's a state mandate. There are multiple state statutes and administrative rules for communicable disease. We do that work with lobby. So our, you know, sexually transmitted infections and other communicable diseases are through the roof, and we have the same staff trying to do that work. So yeah, tick-borne disease is included.
Have you noticed that those are getting worse as the climate changes? We know that with climate change, more diseases will be moving from the south to north.
So all of our vector-borne diseases are clearly impacted by weather-related changes and the warming of weather, absolutely. Tick-borne disease is obviously also impacted by where people go, and as our populations move out of urban centers and are in places where, frankly, there are deer, we talk about deer management as well, that is also makes a difference. So anytime there's a flood, there is a risk of any kinds of GI infections related to flooding and water contamination. So absolutely, there's a relationship.
How's the city of Eau Claire doing from the immunization process? Are they keeping up with their shots, or are we falling behind, or what's happening there?
Sure, it's a great question. So we track, as part of our responsibility and the state mandate, is to track vaccination rates for school-age kids, and we also very closely look at vaccination for all populations, including all adults that should be vaccinated for influenza right about now. That would be one of my closing statements to all of you. If you saw the WEAU story where I talked about flu vaccination, that was my arm that was getting vaccinated. So our rates are not terrible. There is a lot of room for improvement in certain vaccinations and among certain sectors of the population. Our flu vaccination rates, though, are, you know, in the 60%, so we have much improvement that we could do there. There are multiple, again, collaborative groups. We have a Get the Shot committee that works on flu vaccination collaboratively with all our partners, pharmacies, hospitals, clinics, mm-hmm. really to work together to make sure that messages get out. And then we work really closely with the school. So right now, there's adolescent clinics happening, and last week and this week and I think next week, although I don't have the dates in front of me, every middle school in Eau Claire County is having health department nurses come to their school, and we're giving vaccinations for free to any middle school kid and any community member that wants to come to the middle school. So we're working hard to increase those rates. We have some gaps.
Thank you.
Is that giving flu shots, is that do you lose money doing it, or the more you make, or the more you give, the more money you have?
You give. Yeah, probably the more you give, the more money you have, but actually our philosophy for influenza is spending more time making sure people get vaccinated by anybody, and less time on us doing it. And we are doing fewer in our shop. Frankly, you can go to Walgreens and every other place in the world and get vaccinated. And I don't care where people get vaccinated, I want them to be vaccinated. So we're spending a lot more time on that. We call it the assurance role, making sure that people go, tracking rates, talking to people about making it happen, making it easily accessible, but we still give some. So yes, some level of volume does make a difference, because if we have to bill Medicare, if we're only billing two, just it's not very efficient. If we can bill 200, you get more money back.
So for an example, as an employer, the city of Eau Claire, through our insurance arrangement, we had four sessions where people could come on site. So we had people on site offering shots, whereas years ago, that may have been a health department service.
And new this year, the health department employees always got shot with flu vaccination through the health department. We gave it to each other. And this year, we're getting it through group health, and actually, it's fine that we're doing it that way, because they're covered through there, and people that don't have group health insurance, they, you know, if they're not an employee that takes our insurance, then they can get it still from us. But in the end, we try and fill the gap.
Well, Miska failed to mention the really excellent Board of Health that she has.
I knew that was going to get me in trouble.
Janice has solved all of the budget and accounting problems, so we are confident in the budget. So things have changed dramatically in the last couple of years.
Yeah. And And our Board of Health has made an enormous difference. I think one of the challenges, and I don't say that just
for... They don't get paid.
But, you know, one of the challenges in the health department...
Yeah, you can talk about your groups.
The width of service that we provide is really kind of astounding. If you want to look at our annual report and just see, when we did our prioritization process, Shane, how many programs or services were there?
254.
Yeah, 254 things. I mean, people don't realize that. Dale came to our open house for the health department, and he didn't realize some of the things that we did. And that was true of almost every... So one of my invitations is, you know, come over, spend some time with us, because I think people don't realize we have a lot of work to do. There's an amazingly good team of people at the health department, and that is makes all the difference. But we know there's a lot of challenges, and all you have to do is look at the headlines, and there's health almost in everything that can and should be looked at. So we take that seriously. Health in all policy is something that you will continue to hear from me. But you know, it's important that we try and bring a health lens, because that will make a difference in the people that work here, the people that want to come and work here, the businesses that want to be here. And we can, the health department can make a difference in whether or not this place continues to be somewhere that is vibrant, all of those words, right? So safe, sustainable, engaged, and healthy. So, I'm sorry, did you have a question?
No, I was just agreeing.
So get your flu shot and come and visit. If I can close it.
Thank you.
Okay, let's jump ahead to the community enhancement, page D3 of the budget book. Community enhancement fund is really where the room tax dollars that the city collects come into. Most of the funds that come in through the room tax are distributed to Visit Eau Claire. As you, most of you probably recall, we changed the how funds were distributed a couple of years ago. We used to fund a number of outside agencies directly out of the Community Enhancement Fund. Those are now being funded through an application process with Visit Eau Claire. On the revenue side, you may notice a slight decrease in proposed revenues from the room tax versus the 2016 adopted budget. I've been monitoring this year's collections, and I think we're going to make the revenue estimate, but it's going to be close. So I may have been a little bit optimistic with the 2016 revenue budget, so I did dial that back a little bit. There's also some uncertainty in the local hotel motel market with the Plaza Hotel planning to close, but we also had the Lismore and the Oxbow come online, so just kind of want to see how that all shakes out and not be too optimistic on the revenue side at this point. So any questions about community enhancement? Okay, move ahead to non-departmental, page C55 of the budget book. The non-departmental budget is kind of a place where we put things that don't apply to really to one specific department within the city's organization. We have the transfers to various capital accounts as well as other operating accounts. So the general fund transfer to for example, to Hobbs, to the municipal pool, transit, parking are included within the non-departmental budget, as well as the transfers to the capital improvement funds, such as the transit, transportation, parks, and the other capital land, building, and equipments, and the other capital accounts. Fairly significant change in this budget that I believe I mentioned earlier was for expenditure restraint program purposes, we now have to show the library and health department tax levy revenue coming into the general fund, and then we're transferring it back out to the health department and the library. Those transfers also show up in the non-departmental budget, and that accounts for about $4.8 million in transfers back out. So, and within this is the budget where we also include the city's contribution to community television, as well as the senior center. So, any questions about the non-departmental budget? The last budget is CDBG. This will be really quick because they're on a little bit of a different budget calendar. The CDBG budget was actually approved by the City Council earlier this year. This is really just our mechanism for including it within the city budget. And as I said, they're on a little bit different budget cycle. They're on the federal budget cycle as opposed to our calendar year budget cycle. So,
about that budget, has there ever been internal talks about some strategic prioritization of that block grant program?
Yes.
Can you share more? Or you'll share when you're ready.
No, I mean, but we have had discussions about it, and there's an interesting dilemma, I guess, associated with those types of discussions. And I was not in the community at the time, but a couple of years ago, the United Way went through a process where, you know, they basically had been funding the same programs and the same organizations for a number of years, and they decided to discontinue that practice and kind of reset their priorities. And again, as I understand it, that created some difficulties in the communities for those agencies that were no longer being funded. So we have had those conversations as it relates to community development block grant dollars and whether we want to continue the practice of, for the most part, funding the same agencies year after year, or whether we want to establish some, maybe some priorities and go in a little bit different direction, fund activities that go with those priorities or programs that go with those priorities, as opposed to funding the same agencies. Those have really been discussions at this point, and no specific action or recommendations have been taken, because I mean it is a difficult conversation to have.
There can't be an extensive list of eligible agencies that aren't being funded, is it?
I off the top of my head can't think of the number of agencies or programs that submitted proposals that weren't funded, but it was probably somewhere in the neighborhood of half or less were funded. And I think sometimes what happens is when you keep funding the same programs or agencies year after year after year, sometimes people don't apply anymore because they know we're not going to get funded, or it's unlikely that we're going to get funded. Whereas I think if you reset the bar, it kind of opens the door to to other agencies or programs as well.
I think the issue for me is that a lot of agencies get a little bit.
Yeah.
And I think I raised the question a couple of years ago, should we look at funding a few things with a big block of money and make a big impact rather than dribbling out a few thousand here or there? And what Keith said was that if you're an agency that gets a few thousand, you don't want to give that up. You don't want to be dropped from the list. So that's one of the difficult discussions for me.
Yeah.
And for them.
And on what do you set your priorities? Mm-hmm. What?
Well, there are block grant criteria.
There are, but yeah, I mean the community through some process has to establish what those priorities are. Yeah.
But you're right.
This year, are we going to focus on homelessness, or are we going to focus on immunizations, or you might focus on different things. But again, we have had the conversation, but it really hasn't gone beyond that at this point.
As it stands now, what will groups need to apply to start the process?
Yeah, I don't recall, but we can certainly get that information to you. Because Keith, is it January?
Okay. And then we see it in June.
Yeah, it goes through a internal review process, presentations, and some other things.
So this year,
yeah.
No changes whatsoever.
I don't think so.
When is the fee schedule going to be given to us?
That we have a first reading on that at the next council meeting, so you should be getting that on Thursday.
Or Friday.
Thursday or Friday. Yeah.
Thank you.
Questions, comments? So, where we're going to go from here is that, unless Council Member Strobel wants to have a meeting, another work session on the budget, I think we're done with the work sessions.
Next Tuesday, Council Member Larson and I are
visiting. So the budget will be coming back to the City Council at the first Monday in November. Not the first Monday, the first council meeting in November. On the Monday, there'll be a public hearing on the budget. And then Tuesday, we'll be asking the City Council to approve the budget, to adopt the budget. And then at the second council meeting in November, we'll ask the City Council to adopt the tax rates associated with the budget, and then we'll be sending out the property tax bills. If anybody has any questions about it, the budget, please let me know. Feel free to give me a call or shoot me an email, and be happy to provide you whatever information you need, or I'm available for coffee, whatever works.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.